is really when we moved into Kanoi Hall, because when I got here, we were in the old Michael Golden building, and then we were over in Pierce while they were tearing down part of it to rebuild it, and then we came back.
Right.
Now, of course, Discovery Park, and I guess the new computer science building, there's just so many that I can't even keep up with. Sometime I'd like to have a tour around Discovery Park. I missed the opportunity. I was out of town when
well,
they did have a tour.
Well, I have to work that in. Let me back off. This is part two of the interview with Marge Taber, and it's Friday, October the 13th, 2006. And the Katherine Markee, the oral history librarian, is conducting the interview. We'll go ahead. Well, there have been a lot of physical changes, but how about within the school, the demographics and things of that sort within the school? What changes have you noticed? Students,
well,
faculty?
I only can talk about the, now it's called the College of of Technology. And so that's new, because it used to be the School of Technology. I think we still have 8 departments, and they haven't changed. But of course, I think they've grown. And I know in the electrical engineering technology, it's now called electrical and computer engineering technology. And they've they added a master's degree program, and I think they can even get a doctorate, though. That's quite new now, and they did not have those when I was here teaching.
When you were on the faculty, did they have both the undergraduate and could you get a master's as well in your department?
The only way I think you could get a master's, there's another department in the College of Technology that had some graduate courses, and so you could kind of, they special made a program for you, and you probably got a degree out of that department.
Okay.
But now electrical and computer engineering technology has their own degree. They have some advanced, some master's degree level courses. I don't think they have any doctorate level courses yet.
Okay.
But we do have another thing that's happening in the department that I'm a little sorry to see is that one thing in the College of Technology, especially in engineering technology, we could teach our own labs. I mean, that was a requirement. And so then when I taught, I always kind of based the lecture material around the lab to let the lab stimulate the students to want to learn more, because the people that are in technology are not as motivated, say, to the higher level math and that as people in engineering. And so I'd always use the lab to do that. And since we taught our own labs, we could design then the course to fit that. Now, and especially in the freshman level, there are more and more TAs that are running the labs. Now, fortunately, so far, they've gotten people that have gone through the program. And so that's an advantage. But you still don't have the advantage of the person who lectures and does the lab that you can kind of relate those. And I'm sorry to see that go, but that's the way it is in almost all the other departments. In engineering, they might talk about something the first week and then not have the lab until the 10th or 11th week. And then the student has to do more to pull things together.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You've got quite a few professional achievements. Tell us about when you got that senior member of the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers. How did that come about? In 91, do you remember that?
Okay, I remember getting it. All I know is that we had to fill out, there were several in my department that belonged to IEEE. And so I think, I don't know if we had a kind of drive on to increase the people that had been members for a long time. They were trying to get many of us to move up to senior member. And so there was paperwork to fill out. And I think we had to put down some references, but since we had other people in the department trying to help us, so we just had to submit that. Now, of course, I've never been considered as a fellow in there because I haven't done that much in IEEE.
And you know, the incoming president is the dean of engineering for next year, so that's... I understand it's a someone was telling me there's over 350,000 members of this association.
It's a large group.
Of course, I know there are a lot of sub...
And see, all the meetings are out of Indianapolis, you know, and so that's another kind of deterrent.
Did you ever attend any of their meetings at all?
Not here. I think I did when I was in Ohio. I think I probably attended a couple. One I remember, they had the meeting down at the track, and so we got to tour the track, and so I think you could bring a spouse. And so, of course, it was a dinner meal. And I probably attended a couple other that I don't remember.
Okay. Another one you got was the Helen Schliemann Gold Medallion Award for your contributions. And that's a prestigious award,
right.
Helen Schliemann. Did you interact with Helen at all when she was here? Did you ever meet her?
No. Hmm. Since I was involved with SWE, those women like to put people up for awards and things like that. And so they had put me up one year, and I got a letter saying, you know, I was nominated. But I think this time when they put me up, I'm not sure if it was because I didn't talk with them, but they got more people in the department involved, and they got Bob and Helen Hoffer, who are big benefactors of Purdue. I understand they wrote a letter, and they did a lot of getting resources. And I know the next year, I think you knew Linda Ewing, didn't you? She was a very good friend. We were cancer buddies together, and I know I helped get her nominated, and I know you really got to do your homework and dig out all the things that are great about the person and get the right people to write letters.
Right. The nominations is very key.
Right.
Yes, exactly. And I know that, and you gave me that material, that you got I know you've been at the Society of Women Engineers. I've seen you at the brunch, and there's the Marge Taber Award for Outstanding Women in Technology. Is that still going? And I believe, as I mentioned, I have gone to the luncheons, and I've seen you go up there and give that award.
I don't know if I want this really on the tape, but
Dean... Well, we can ox that out.
The dean had agreed...
Well, you've already said not on the tape, so this one we'll just take out.
Okay. The dean had agreed to continue. I started the award because
you did.
I felt that we needed to honor women in engineering technology, because the women in engineering, there's so many 4.0 students. They used to be 6.0, but there's so many of them that really our women in engineering technology didn't have a chance. And so I set this up specifically that we would have either a woman in mechanical engineering technology or CIMT, which is under mechanical engineering technology, or somebody in EET. And I don't know how many years I paid for it, but then the dean of the School of Technology, which was Dean Gentry, he continued paying for that. And then now we have a new dean, and he paid for it a couple years, and then they decided that they didn't get as much bang out of that, and they didn't let me know. I called the night before. Well, it was the Friday before the dinner. I didn't know what the dinner was on that Sunday.
The brunch is usually on
brunch. Yeah,
sorry.
But it's usually like around the 14th. This past year it was early, the 5th or something like that. And so I called and talked to the woman and head of Women in Engineering Programs. And she said, well, the dean stopped supporting that. And then, I don't know, she said then, Associate Dean Sadowski was supposed to let me know that they were doing that. And when I called Dean Sadowski, she says, I'm sorry, but it was too late then. I couldn't. And so since then, I've set up an award that should go at least for the next 10 years. And what the dean wanted to do is to, they have a school College of Technology Awards, and he wanted to least that's what I understood, have a Marge Taber Award, but it would go to any woman in the college.
In the college.
And that's not what I wanted, because some of the women are a little kind of uppity-ish in women in engineering, especially to women in engineering technology, just like the men are, you know, because they say, you didn't have the qualifications to get in this College of Engineering, you know, so you took the second route. And I wanted the people, I wanted the engineers to be aware that engineering technology was a legitimate group, and that they could, once in a while we had a woman that was good enough, that had a 4.0, that would qualify for one of their awards, like General Motors. General Motors gives out, I don't know, 8 or 10, and, but if they weren't, because many of our women have good additional, you know, they do things, they do mentoring, they're part of clubs and that, but they don't have that 4.0. That's very difficult in our area to get 4.0s, to have women. And so, I met with, I can't think of her name, the woman in, it's head of Women in Engineering Programs, and I donated money so that we would continue that, at least for the next 10 years.
That's very nice. It means, have you ever, on any of the awardees, do you ever keep in touch, or have you kept in touch with the students that have gotten the awards? You know, I know there's a picture, there's always a picture taken afterwards, you know, outside there.
No.
There's not much interaction.
Well, but what's interesting...
Because they were with your college and your department.
Yeah, well, what's interesting, the ones in, see, there was either MIT or...
MET or...
MET or CIMT or EET, but we had... two or three of the women come back for graduate work. The past couple of years, we had a couple of women graduates, and they had gotten either the award from SWE or either the scholarship. And so then they got another scholarship again. So that was kind of neat.
Yes, that's nice.
I was hoping we could get enough money. See, the problem is once a woman goes out and works in industry, it's a really big... to be able to then to go back to school and not have that money coming in. And so I'd really like to get more funds in the scholarship for, not the Swiss scholarship, but the scholarship for the department, so that we could double the award for graduate students, but that hasn't worked out yet.
Okay, there it is. And I know you've been really involved with SWE, and they gave you the Distinguished Award, and you gave me that and showed me that in your magazine.
Now that was a national award.
I know.
Award.
And what was your reaction when you...
Oh, it was fabulous. See, I was...
Tell us a little bit about
I was a member at large. Because
of SWE?
Of SWE. That's the not the...
Not the local chapter, but it's a national organization.
Right. And member at large, MAL is what they called, because we did not have a chapter here. Now, a couple times they had chapters set up in Indianapolis, but... one time that I was could have been really involved, and it disbanded because they had people that either moved on to other locations or they just couldn't devote time to it. And so they tried, SWE then tries to have MAL chapter, which pulls in all the people that can't attend
the national.
And so that is probably, I don't know how they got my name, but somebody gave them my name, and then the woman who wrote the article was the head of the committee at that time, and I helped get information for them because they didn't know names of students because they needed letters, and I have a folder at home. I was told at that time, anytime I get feeling down or discouraged, I should pull out that folder because they had the letters of recommendation.
You got copies?
I got them someplace at home.
Nice. That's nice.
And yeah, somebody sent them. I think the woman who gathered the information. And so it was kind of neat because we didn't have a big group you know, back of me. One of the fellows that wrote a note for me actually is back teaching in our department again. He was a student, and so he made some comments. And another one was when I was at Cuyahoga Community College. He was a student, and then he became our lab technician in the department. And then he moved on to Cleveland State. And I can't quote him, but he made a very... But see, I worked with him as I was chair, or they called it academic unit leader for a while. And so I worked with this fellow when he was a technician. And then he moved on.
And you helped him a lot.
Well,
probably
I guess so. He thought very highly of me.
Yeah.
And so I don't remember. It's been a long time since I've looked at that folder. But they were very complimentary.
Yes.
So the Mal group pulled all this stuff together and nominated me. And it was,
did you get a letter? How did you find out?
Well, I think I got a letter.
Okay.
But I was a double dipper that year. That was the same year I got a fellow. And so again, I guess since they had all the material, they could work on getting me nominated as a fellow of SWE. So that was a while ago too, but that was really great because sometimes you know as a prof you don't get to find out what the students really think, because when they get out in industry and then come back, then it's nice. They usually will say what they did, and I have a few. I know I have one at it was a graduate of Cleveland State. They had put in their alumnus magazine about the award, and so one of my former students contacted Cleveland State, said that he, and they told him about the scholarship there, that he would contribute some. And so he, a woman at Cleveland State got us together because of the privacy. And so I couldn't remember him. I felt so bad. He sent me a picture. Handsome-looking man, but it was, of course, it went back to when I was at Cuyahoga Community College, which, I don't know, it was in the 60s or early 70s, but you know, we did correspond, and he did contribute something. I don't know what he contributed to the scholarship.
Very nice.
But,
very nice.
He felt that was important enough, and he had a growing family. They were young kids, so he didn't have that much, you know, extra money. When the kids are young, you want to, you need all the money that you can get.
Exactly, that's right. Now, within the school, the colleges, you got two keys for honor. One is the scholarship, which you talked about, and that was that endowed scholarship made possible by Helen Hoffer and Hoffer Plastics. And then they renamed the Hoffer Microcomputer Lab, is named after you, isn't it?
Yes, the scholarship, when I came back from my surgery in 1990, I talked with the dean, and I was Dean Gentry, and I said, I don't want to wait until I die. I'd like to start a scholarship. And so I contributed $2,000, and then he added $3,000 to make it $5,000. And then that was close to the time, it was 92, I stopped working, that when they renamed the lab, also, at that time, Helen contributed $10,000, so that at that time, the scholarship was endowed at $15,000. That's all you needed. I'm not sure what you need now. I know Cleveland State now needs $25,000 to even start. But I could never have done. I'm like Bob and Helen. Bob and Helen supported like our department, but we had to write a letter and tell them what we needed and what we were going to do with it, and they would contribute between $25,000 and $50,000, you know, to do that. But every time we would have to justify what we were getting, and then of course when we got the money and got the equipment, we would write them too. But they were the type that would give money. To me, $50,000 is a lot of money. but to some of the people that have more money, $50,000 isn't that much. And I know they were requested to make a donation of $1 million for something, but they prefer to do the smaller amounts and do it over a period of time. And they gave money to endow that. And we always called the lab that Bob and Helen, really, both of them, but that called that the Huffer Lab. It was just something, well, I taught in it, and so I was the one who said Huffer Lab, and we put up a name and that. And then at the time I was retiring medically, I don't know who asked who, but my husband tells me they called him and said, could you come in? We're going to rename the lab. And he says, well, it's the Huffer Lab. What's Bob going to say about it? And they said, well, it was his idea that we rename the lab. And so, they said it was great that they could do that while I was still alive, instead of waiting until I died to do that. And so then they told the department that, it should be called my lab. And it's been in two locations now. It was in the original location for a while, and then it moved over to a larger area. But then they had too many people coming in and using it, and not enough profs to be able to handle it. And so they went back to a smaller room so that they could just keep it for the purpose of the computer. To my knowledge, he is still continuing to donate money for the lab. I think the last was, I'm not sure, it was within a year. But he and his wife, they're getting very up in age.
What is, were they a Purdue grant? I mean, how did they happen to, always support the school of college?
No, they, from what I understand, they actually wanted, I don't know what the new name is. It was a home economics graduate.
Oh, okay.
And he graduated, I'm not sure if it was in chemistry, but he went
to work. They're both Purdue grads.
Yes.
Oh, I see.
Yes, and their whole family, except now one of the granddaughters or great-granddaughters, wanted to go to Illinois. Everyone else came to Purdue, so they're big Purdue people. And she had wanted to contribute to, I think it's consumer.
It's consumer and family science.
Family science. She had wanted to contribute to them, but they didn't seem to be interested in her contributing. I don't know what. And so she never, I don't know, she gives money now to them, but didn't contribute that. From what I understand, my department head, Steve Cheshire, met Bob, I think, on an airplane. Traveling for, I guess, two different, but they happened to be on the same plane. And so you know how people talk to each other. And so I guess Steve told them about our program. And it was, within the next year, since Bob came here all the time, because he used to follow the football games and that. Now they used to drive down every football weekend and, of course, be part of the fish fry and all those activities. He's contributed to, I think, the sports complexes, too. The golf, I know. And he contributed to one of the other departments in the school of technology. But he came down to see our department, and so I met him then. And one of the times he was coming down later, I had developed a little Boilermaker special that ran on a computer. And so I showed him. But after he became familiar with me, that's when several of us in the department head, another fella, and I, we needed funds for the computers. My one colleague was going up to getting the computers from Brookston, where they made computers, putting together pieces that you never heard of where they were from. And this was, at the time, you could not buy a personal computer that was capable enough of doing the work. So I talk to Intel Corporation. You've heard of Intel. They said that if we could get some funds, that they would then provide more funds. And so we were able that we could get some development stations. Now, these were professional-type, industry-type computers that our students could work on. So we thought this was the way to go instead of the other way of finding the cheapest pieces to put together if we could have an industrial system. And so we went up to Bob's place up in Elgin, Illinois. And we couldn't, there wasn't a time when we were there. He showed us around the plant, but there wasn't a time there that we could really bring up the subject of could he fund, help us fund this. But he knew at the end, he says, I'll call you and we can talk. And so that's how it started. We started small. I don't know if we asked for $25,000, but it was a smaller amount. Of course, it bought a lot more than it does today. And so we started getting, and I was the one who worked very closely with Bob and really Helen. But Helen was more on the scholarship, where Bob was more in the equipment area. And I think they have a foundation that they've set up, a trust that then probably, you know, you have to take minimum distributions. And I know they're a big, they've given lots of money to many, but they want to kind of have a personal touch with their gifts. And so this was one thing that I did when I was there, is always made sure that we told them what happened to the equipment and using it. And then if there were anything that came up during the school year that had nothing to do with funding, but that they might be interested in, we'd write them and keep them up to date. And that's really how Helen continued helping us periodically, not every year, with providing more funds in the scholarship. That we'd send her copies of the letters that the women wrote. This was a requirement that I have, and I have it at all the schools now, is that they have to write a letter telling us about themselves. Not the purpose of a thank you letter, but usually there's a committee in the department or a committee in the school that chooses the scholarship winners. And so the people that sponsor the scholarships very seldom know what they're doing. Well, so Helen was so pleased with some of the letters and the women that were getting the scholarships that she then contributed more money to the scholarships. And this is when I was at Akron U and talking, I had asked the fellow that was in charge of getting annuities and development about doing this because and how to go about achieving this at Akron. And he said, he told me this time when he was down there, it was another company that he was working with, and he kind of asked the fellows that got the scholarships for that company to do the same thing. And that company came back and said, this is the first time that this ever happened. I'm really pleased knowing about this, and then they contributed more money. And so, because there's a lot.
Never lose the personal touch.
Right.
It pays off in the long run.
This is good. But I felt, even though I had assigned work to do, and that I felt that Bob and Helen were number one as far as trying to keep them informed as to what was happening, and they were always good at reciprocating. Sometime they might tell us funds would be a little tight this year, or sometimes they might tell us that we could get funds actually for 2 years if we had that many requests. So we always would try to keep our requests within what kind of was the parameters that we really had set up originally.
I would jump in by saying I think that's good. I think it helps you so you're not going. You know the the boundaries in which you're operating, well, and it makes it a lot easier.
He's a business manager, right, and he knows that if you're going to ask for money, if you can tell him what you want and why you want it, that you're going to probably make use of it. and then
because you thought you've done your homework.
You've done your homework beforehand, so when you actually get that equipment, it will be used for the purpose that you asked for.
Right, exactly. Okay, now you retired in 92. What have you been doing since then? Do you still keep in touch with the school? Have you come back and given any guest lectures or anything?
I did one. Our College of Technology has a course in the freshman year for women to try to get them oriented as to what field they might be in and what the technologists do. And they asked me to speak at one of those. And I was kind of honored because they'd have people come in from Michigan and all over. They didn't just ask the local people, but I spoke to one of them. I'm not sure what's happened to the class. It was probably 2 or 3 years ago.
Uh-huh.
I usually stop in the department 2 or 3 times a year because I continue contributing to the scholarship. And also, a week from Monday night, we're going to have our own scholarship kind of awards, and that's when they take the pictures. They'll have finger food. It's at 6:30. And
at the college?
This is just for ECET, the Electrical and Computer Engineering Technology. We already had one for the whole college that was a month ago or so.
Yeah.
And but this one is just for our. This one, they'll have pictures with us and the department head. And this is one that we usually will send the pictures along with the letters that the women write.
Based on what you shared, which you'll see on the transcript, I certainly would like to make a comment for the tape that you have continued to be involved with students, and I think the fact that you've endowed scholarships is just a wonderful thing, and the students will always really appreciate that, and you value the role that education can play in their lives.
It's a compliment. So. This was something neat, and I don't know
if... You've thought it not only to just your major institution that you spent most of your life at, but also the others that had an impact on you.
Right. Cleveland State and University of Akron. It was one thing I got, one of the women that got the scholarship this past year, not coming, but past, she wrote me a little note from California and told me what she was doing. And I took that note back when I went to see University of Akron. And they were nice and thought that was great. I don't know if Purdue gives out the addresses, so that they can, after they leave, whether they could then write a letter. But I don't know how she got my address, but she had written
I think it varies somewhat, but depending on the nature of the scholarship and what kind of the guidelines are, and it could vary by the school, too. So I think there are some variations in it. As you know, the transcript and tape is going to go over to the Archives and Special Collections. You got any comments on archives or preservation? Any comments on that?
I just think it's a very important activity, especially for women in engineering, because there were only a few of us a long time ago, and now Purdue is one of the leading schools in the country at graduating women in engineering. But I always kind of think the women in engineering technology, too, are also important. But I think you need to have records of what people did in the past. This is one thing why SWE, I'm not sure how well the program's going, but they started a program to archive some of the members, try to catch them before they died, so that they could get some memories.
And adds enrichment to whatever organization is doing the taping and the transcripting. Yeah. A couple things. Got any questions that I failed to ask that you want to talk about or any topics that you want to come back to?
No.
Okay. How about an outstanding event in your life? What would you, how could you think of anything specific?
Well, I was pretty excited to come to Purdue. I thought, I know when I give talks at cancer groups. That was one thing I
That's one thing you've been doing, and do that locally?
In the 90s, yeah. And one of the things I used to say, well, I taught at Cuyahoga Community College in Cleveland, and then I joined the big leagues when I came over to Purdue. So I think that was, and the way it worked out, I think we talked about it, that my husband was able to come and follow, which is difficult for many of the couples that get married. Husband wants to go one place and the wife goes another, and to try to be able to both go to a place and be able to continue.
Tell us a little bit about your involvement. You and you've been involved with the cancer people as well?
Yeah, I've been involved with American Cancer Society. I was active in that until I got sick again in 98. And then during that time, we had a Cancer Mount program, which I was...
What's it called? Cancer?
Cancer Mount. That means... that's
Cancer, C-A-N.
Yeah, well, it's C-A-N, but it's the surmount that you can deal with cancer. And what this group was to be able to link up a person that was newly diagnosed with cancer with somebody that had the similar type cancer, that was a survivor and that had lived for several years. And I did that. I think that group started in like 93. And it was part of the American Cancer Society. They actually discontinued it because it was so difficult to get people. The coordinator is so important in the sense to be able to match up these people. And now I think it's even harder with the privacy. But I know when I lost my lung, I know I asked the doctor, I said, you say you could live with one lung. I said, but how well? Is there anybody I could talk to see what they're doing? And he said, well, the nurse will look up somebody for you. Well, a couple months passed, and I called. Oh, we just haven't had time to look up because of privacy. They would have to get that person's permission to have them give me their name. And so this group, it was so nice. One of my first persons, even
though
I
did you coordinate the group?
Yes.
You're the coordinator.
Even though I had, mine was metastatic rectal cancer, went to the lung. I had a woman that I worked with that was a lung cancer, and she had lost just one lung. And so I was able to, some of the things that I experienced, I mentioned to her, I said, I never thought that this would happen. And she still writes me at Christmas time, and she's still alive, still going, and she's volunteering now, trying to give back to the community. And so that was a major activity. But also in the 90s, that's when I started volunteering at Wabash Center, working with the developmentally handicapped. And actually in 1988, I started out in Arizona.
I was going to ask you about that. Are you still involved with that? Because I've
yes.
got that from the article. Do you go out there, or how
yes,
does that...
I go out there twice a year. I'm going to be going out there October 27th to November 11th this year.
Tell us a little bit about what facility and how you learned about it.
Well, how I learned about this was back in 88. We had a church group that went out there. The minister that set up that group knew the minister at our church, and this was a different work trip group because we had adults along with youth, where most of the work trips during the summer are youth and the only adults are the chaperones. But this was purposely designed to have about half. We had 26 people that went out to Rainbow Acres. Rainbow Acres is now in existence over 30 years, and they provide homes. They live there on campus for the developmentally handicapped adults. They have the adults. And I was in one of the homes, and I was helping one of the, they call them ranchers, helping one of the ranchers, and I thought, gee, they could really use a computer. And so the next year, when I went out, at that time I only went out a week in the summertime, and there was two or three other people that came back in 89, went with us, but again, only 1 week. And they said, well, somebody donated a computer. And I thought, okay. And I was talking with IBM. They wouldn't donate a computer, but they ended up donating $500 towards a computer. But when I went out there, the person who had donated the computer was no good. It was a business computer that was designed for business, and they just wanted a write-off. And I could never get that computer up and running. But the next year, we got our, there was a, I don't know how they made contact, but there was a person that had retired, and he was a Macintosh person. And he had a Mac in his mobile home, and they came and stayed on the ranch for a while, and all the ranchers were just crazy about it. And they asked me, you know, if we're going to get another, and I donated some money so that we could get a computer. I said, what's more important is the person, that there's going to be a person that knows the computers there. And so since he was going to be there, and Macs were very well known in schools, that I said that would be a good way to go. So we started a learning center there. And I only went out in the summertime while I was teaching. But then when I went on medical leave, I started going out twice a year. Usually go out for 2 weeks at a time, because that's the maximum time my husband can do without me. He does not go.
No.
He takes me down to the airport and picks me up, but that's not his activity. So I go and work with... it's a long story. We had, they had two facilities. They had Rainbow Acres, which then was the office was at that same site. Then they had a Sunburst Farm. And the Sunburst Farm people were a little higher level. And they at the beginning, they had 40 in each group. Well, when economics became tough in the later 90s, they decided that they would merge the groups. And so they moved the 40 people that were at Sunburst Farm and sold that facility to Rainbow. And so now, and the 40 we could manage real well. And even when I came out for 2 weeks at a time, I could see each one for two or three times. Mm-hmm. And that worked great. And they even got a house parent that would be in the computer lab for a while, and they had a computer lab and also what we called the classroom, so that they could do some pencil paper activities and also work on the computer. Well, in 98 they moved all them over to Rainbow, and since then they've had a building campaign because the original homes there needed to be replaced. So now they have 8 beautiful homes, but they have 10 ranchers in each home. They experimented on the way of having more than one rancher in a bedroom, but that didn't work. So these new homes have 10 and a house parent. So they have somebody in the houses at all times, but they now have to take care of 10 ranchers. They do have one house that's independent living. I'm not sure how that's working out. It's fellas, and I don't know how well they're cooking and things like that. But since I was doing that, I had heard of Laura, the Lafayette adult. It was at that time it was Reading Academy. Now it's the Resource Academy. And there was one woman, Vicki Jones, who worked with the developmentally handicapped. And she was the one who later went out to Wabash Center. So there was a site of Laura so that the people at Wabash could come and go to class. And so I talked with her, and she gave me a couple suggestions as to some software that would be needed. And then when I, again, since in 92 I was not working, that was my first volunteer activity. And I'm still continuing to do that. Vicki Jones, who kind of grew up helping them, smaller classes, and then got up to 8 in the classroom. She was needed at the jail, so now she's at the jail site for Laura. And she's had some articles in the paper about what she does. And so that left a big void over there. They put somebody in at Wabash Center, but she did not know the computer, she did not know the software, she did not know the learners, and so I tried to help. I was putting in, while my mother was here in town, I didn't put in as much time because I needed to see her quite often, keep up with her finances and that. But it was after that, after she died, that Vicki moved on. But then I was doing Monday, Wednesday, and Friday over there, and that got to be too much. I'm either doing Monday and Wednesday or Monday and Friday, but I can only be there about 3 hours at a time, otherwise I get too exhausted. So on Monday, I help in class, but then on Wednesday, I usually go in early and work on the computers and help try to get new software. This is the problem with organizations that are charitable organizations. They don't have enough help. And the people that they do have, that they pay, are overworked. And this is not just true at Rainbow. It's not true just at Wabash Center.
It's overall.
It's overall. I know there was another organization I heard just this week that people are burdened, you know, because they just expect so much to be done, and they don't have enough volunteers. This is a problem that happened at the American Cancer Society. It used to be we'd get a lot of people, men here, working on graduate degrees, and their wife, them didn't try to find a job. They would volunteer, and so you had young people. Now the only people they can get to be volunteers are people that have retired from their jobs, because the young people need to go out and work yeah. to bring money in for school or for to pay for a home or whatever.